The speaker for Class 1 is the principal investigator for a NASA mission to the only metal world in our solar system. I think the real purpose of all space missions, she says, is to encourage everyone to take a bolder step in their own lives, to imagine they could do something bigger than they thought they could, braver than they thought they could, something that they can drive forward. She took her own bold step into space 10 years after graduating MIT with a master's in geochemistry. On the same day that her son started kindergarten, she returned to MIT to pursue a PhD in geology and geophysics. With a research agenda that included the study of volcanic activity and planetary formation, she became associate professor for geology at MIT, then director of the Department of Terrestrial Magnetism at the Carnegie Institution for Science, and now director of the School of Earth and Space Exploration at Arizona State University. In January of 2017, NASA approved her proposal for a mission to 16 Psyche, one of the 10 most massive asteroids in the asteroid belt orbiting the Sun between Mars and Jupiter. The mission is scheduled to launch in 2022 and to arrive in 2026. Made of iron and nickel, 16 Psyche may be the exposed core of an early planet, offering a glimpse into our own origins here on Earth. It is a mission motivated by our speaker's powerful desire to be curious, to be driven, and to use our exploring hearts. Please join me in welcoming director and foundation professor at the School of Earth and Space Exploration and director of the Interplanetary Initiative at Arizona State University and principal investigator for the NASA Psyche mission, Linda Elkins-Tanton.
Well, 2 years ago, right around this time of year, I was standing and speaking much like this, but under quite different circumstances, not to this group of old and new friends, but in fact to a panel of 30 professional NASA reviewers whose job it was to decide whether or not they would recommend the Psyche mission for flight. And as you already have heard, it was approved. But that day was one of the most intense days of my life. I could talk about it for an hour. Actually, I'm probably still too traumatized to talk about it. It was at the culmination of a week of on-site preparation by the team of then 140 people. But that day and that week and the 6 years that preceded it paid off because, in fact, on January 4th, 2017, the NASA Associate Administrator wakened me in the morning with a phone call. And the happy news that we'd been selected for flight. NASA, the Psyche mission is named after Psyche, the asteroid. And so indeed we are sending a robotic spacecraft to a metal world. Now, humankind, we have visited rocky worlds like Mars and the Moon and Venus and Mercury, and we've visited moons made of ice, and we've visited gas giants like Jupiter, but humankind has never before seen a metal world. We're pretty certain Psyche is made of metal because of its radar properties, but if there's one thing we've learned about exploration, whether it's exploration of the new world, exploration of the North Pole, exploration of a new kind of solar system body, nature surprises us. And so, although we're standing here asserting to you today that it's made of metal, and we suspect that it's the core of a little planet, perhaps in a few years you'll remember and know that we were wrong. And there are very few places where humankind hasn't been, and this is one of them. It's a huge honor to go there. And so, indeed, we will launch this robotic probe in August of 2022. I invite you all to come to Florida for the launch, August 6th. 2022, put it in your calendar. and we'll rendezvous with Psyche and begin orbiting in 2026. Well, NASA is very clear that this mission is about science. But for me, as was very kindly pointed out in the introduction, it's never just been about science. We explore, I think, because we can't help it. I think it's in our DNA. As humans, we are just compelled to explore. But I do truly believe that the reason that countries pay for this, not just as a substitute for war, not just for posturing, but because it does encourage everyone to take a bolder step in their own lives. And that is, that's what we wish for everyone. Now, before I return to science to get my PhD, and incidentally, I must, because he was mentioned, say that my son is right here, who went to kindergarten the week I went to graduate school, and we did our homework together for many, many years. I worked in business for almost a decade, and that time in business gave me a very deep appreciation for high-functioning teams, the criticality of being able to work in high-functioning teams, which perhaps is not... it's not really unkind of me to point out that that's often not something that we're trained in doing as academics, is working in interdisciplinary teams. I really learned that, and I also frankly got a deep skepticism about the value of many of the ways that we spend our time as people. I think we have choices. And so I came back very motivated to think about what is the biggest question that I could ask? How could I make a team that really had an effect? And it began several decades of conversation in our family about what is a virtuous career? What are the things we could do that would truly make a difference? Now that Psyche is deep into formulation, we're up to about 300 people. We're going to go to 500 or 600 people on this team. We're across the country. I have about 15 hours of regular telecons every week, and then there's the extra. It's we're deep in it, and I have a really increased appreciation for the criticality of working in large interdisciplinary teams. So on these teams, the systems engineer has a great reverence for the knowledge of the scheduler, and the marketer has a great reverence for the knowledge of the graphic designer. And these kinds of things are not taught in school. They're not taught in college. They're not taught in high school. And so that's really the point of what I'm trying to say today. These things are not taught in college. The traditional mode of education is one of content delivery. I, the instructor, bring my knowledge and I deliver it to you, the learner. And I would guess that most of us in this room excelled at that model of education. And in fact, that's why we're here now. By the end of high school, most of us who are going on have become experts in the blind acceptance of content and the regurgitation of it onto an exam. That is almost exactly antithetical to what I think that we actually need in this world. It's almost exactly antithetical to truly understanding content and taking action. And so what I posit is that we need to abandon the blind acceptance of content, and we need to train a generation of problem solvers who are motivated, who recognize and are motivated by unsolved problems, who understand and have the courage to struggle forward in partial steps over time to find a solution. We're living in interesting times. Imagine if our society was fully trained to ask the question, how does that reporter know that? Why should I believe that information? Content is ubiquitous. Content is no longer the differentiator. We are drowning in content. What we lack is critical problem solvers. And so, what am I proposing? How can we do this? Sounds good, I hope. I hope it sounds good. Well, let me introduce you to one thing that we've developed. We've been working on this for some time, not just within my academic group or with my colleagues at ASU or across the country, also in our tech startup, Beagle Learning, trying to find effortless ways to introduce critical thinking and problem solving into the classroom. And one really powerful idea I want to share today is the concept of a natural next question. I think this is actually the key to not just problem solving and not just critical thinking, but also even to leadership. And it goes like this. Imagine that you have a goal. You have some big goal, some big problem that's on your mind. Say your question is, how could visiting a metal asteroid teach me about the inside of the Earth or how planets are formed? Or what if your question is, how can I get an education when girls aren't allowed to go to school in my town? These are the kinds of problems I would like everyone in the world to have the grit and the resilience to take some steps toward. And so probably you would go on the internet or to your library, you'd ask your friend or you'd interview someone, you'd start with a little seed of content. Then comes the natural next question. Rather than asking a question about what you already know, which is what we're mainly trained to do, we would ask our natural next question, the question that takes us one step away from what we know and toward our big goal, which is too far to be reached in one question, but you can do it in many little questions. And as you tune your ability to ask your natural next question, you become better and better at problem solving. We are doing that in the classroom right now and in the lab, and it is transformational. I had a sophomore working on his natural next questions every week for 4 weeks, and at the end of the fourth week, in fact, I've already quoted him, he said, "Now when I listen to the news or I read the media, I ask myself, how do they know that? And I want to ask more questions about it." And he said that had never been the case before. I think this is a beautiful, simple one step on the way to problem solving. And so a mission, a big science question, a big problem, and the wish that everyone in the world would feel empowered and enabled to take a bolder step in their own lives. And I think it's up to us here today, to make sure that that opportunity is available. Thank you very much.